All right, let's do it. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the UnidosUS Virtual Town Hall, COVID-19 vaccine. Your questions answered, and that's exactly what we want to do today, is answer your questions about the COVID-19 vaccine. My name is Nicole Suarez. I am the anchor for Noticias Telemundo, and I'm very happy to be here today for this important, important conversation. I have a few housekeeping items to get through before we officially get started. So I'd like to mention that we have a simultaneous translation in Spanish for this program. So for this option, all you have to do is go to the interpretation icon on the bottom right of your screen and select Spanish. Quiero mencionar antes de comenzar que hemos creado la opción sobre la traducción simultánea para esta conversación y para activarlo solamente tiene que ir al icono de interpretación en la parte inferior derecha de la pantalla y seleccionar español. Lo voy a repetir una vez más. Tiene que ir a la parte inferior derecha de la pantalla y seleccionar español en el icono de interpretación. Also, I'd like to mention that this session is going to be recorded, and after we've concluded the chat, everyone's going to receive a link. That way you can reference information and you can share it also with your friends and family. The chat box has been disabled, but you can also submit questions live via the Q&A box. And at the end of the program, we'll also be offering different options for you to stay informed and to keep your family and yourself safe during this pandemic. So, without further ado, I'd like to officially start this conversation talking about something that obviously we have all been living through this last year, the COVID-19 pandemic. It is no secret that it has disproportionately affected the Latino community. We've seen how our community is still getting sick, our friends, our family members. We're actually 4 times more likely to get hospitalized and 3 times more likely to die. We're also suffering from unemployment. We're seeing how our kids are falling behind in school. So we're really getting hit on all fronts. And as we know, one of the key elements to end this pandemic is the COVID-19 vaccine. In the United States, there are currently 2 vaccines that have been approved for use. We have the Pfizer Moderna also that has been distributed coast to coast. We know that healthcare workers are receiving them. Elderly people are also receiving them. But again, our community is being disproportionately affected by this because we are not being vaccinated as high of rates as other communities are. And this is because of many factors, which include mistrust in the vaccine, lack of information, lack of access to healthcare. And that's why we have partnered up to do this very, very important conversation. And so UnidosUS has partnered up with CBS Health, also with their media partner Telemundo, to do this town hall. And I'd like to introduce our panelists for today, our experts that are here today to talk to us. First up, we have Carmen Vergara. She is Chief Operations Officer of Esperanza Health Centers in Chicago, Illinois. They are a UnidosUS affiliate, and they have been doing a great work really getting out COVID-19 vaccines in the Latino community, also doing the COVID-19 testing. We also have Dr. Sri Shaguturo, and he is the Chief Medical Officer, SVP of CVS Caremark and CVS Health, also whose leadership is gonna be very, very valuable to this conversation. And we are very happy to also welcome Governor Jared Polis of Colorado, whose leadership has also been extremely important during the rollout of the vaccine in his state. But first and foremost, we'd also like to get to talk to Janet Murguia, CEO and President of UnidosUS. She has been doing incredible work as well to get the information out there to our community. And she actually was able to have a direct conversation with Dr. Marcela Nunez-Smith. She is Associate Professor, Internal Medicine of Public Health and Management at Yale University. And she's also on the Biden-Harris Task Force for the Equity Distribution of COVID-19 Vaccines. So without further ado, Janet, take it away.
Thank you, Nicole. And by the way, congratulations on your new role as host of Telemundo's new morning show, Hoy Día, where you're going to continue to keep our community informed, not just about COVID-19, but all the pressing issues. We're very proud of you. And thanks for your partnership today. Let me just say again, welcome to everyone. And thank you for joining us for this very important and timely conversation. Almost 10 months after the start of this global pandemic, we just have to acknowledge this painful journey for our country and our community, but for our country, more than 25 million cases and more than 420,000 deaths. Our Latino community, as you heard from Nicole, has suffered disproportionately. We're 18% of the population, but 21% of COVID-19 cases and 13% of deaths nationwide. And we are also four times more likely to be hospitalized for COVID-19. As a result, UnidosUS has been at the forefront of ensuring culturally and linguistically appropriate response to the COVID-19 pandemic for our Latino community. In 2020, we led the way on being the go-to source for our community and how to protect themselves and their families from COVID. Now, though, I think that we can be at a hopeful juncture because almost 6 weeks ago, the first COVID vaccine was administered in the U.S. I'm grateful that I was able to receive the vaccine at an UnidosUS affiliate community health center, Mary Center, here in Washington, D.C., just this past weekend. Mary Center is just one of our many affiliate partners in community health centers, which are playing such a critical role in vaccine distribution. An undertaking of this magnitude will need support from every sector. So we are also grateful to our private and public health partners. As vaccines start rolling out across the country, it's important for our community to get the latest information from trusted sources. And we are honored to have an expert panel to give us the facts and answer your questions and to be that source of information, including our many affiliates who are part of our network. Before I turn this back over to our moderator, Nicole Suarez, let me give just special thanks to all of our guests for your time to ensure that our community has timely, accurate information about the vaccine and tools to make the best decision for themselves and their loved ones. I also wanted to give a very special thanks to our sponsor, CVS Caremark, and specifically Dr. Shree for all the work they are doing on behalf of our community around testing, communication, and implementation of vaccine distribution. We encourage all of our community to take action and get vaccinated. I can personally attest that it's not painful, and it gives me great sense of comfort knowing that I will be part of an effort to help us get back to our families and those reunions that we want to be able to enjoy. In addition to our work to keep you informed and support our community-based affiliates, we are going to continue at UnidosUS to advocate to ensure that policymakers are providing appropriate funding and implement an equitable vaccine distribution plan that reflects the true needs and experiences of our community. As we know, governors are going to be crucial to this process, including the implementation of an equitable vaccine distribution. That's why we are very honored to have Governor Jared Polis of Colorado join today's conversation and discuss the ways in which his state is meeting the needs of his diverse residents on vaccine distribution. He's not been shy to say there have been challenges and it's not easy, but we appreciate his championing the importance of getting it right and keeping our community and communities of color top of mind. So we're very grateful to Governor Polis for his leadership in this critical moment. We know that states cannot do it alone and that leadership from the top matters. And this includes a clear, coordinated, well-resourced, and equity-centered federal response. So we're hopeful that President Biden's national strategy for the COVID-19 response and pandemic preparedness will give state and local leaders the clarity and resources needed to ensure a timely and equitable distribution of vaccines. And UnidosUS is committed to using all of our assets and our affiliates appreciate Carmen Vergara representing Esperanza, again, Mary Center, and so many others to promote vaccine awareness, acceptance, and take up among the Latino community. And we'll also continue to push for federal relief on our other issues that affect the health of our families, including those economic ones. You know, I was so privileged last week. I had the opportunity to talk with Dr. Marcela Nunez Smith, the head of the President Biden's Health Equity Task Force, about the administration's plans for the vaccine. Here now is the video from that highly informative conversation, and let's take it there. Dr. Nunez Smith, thank you for joining us. It's a real honor for us to have you. I know that you're just now also going to be beginning a new role. You've had several roles as you've worked with the Biden-Harris campaign, the transition, and now you'll be chairing the COVID-19 Health Equity Task Force for the Biden-Harris administration. Welcome.
Thank you so much. Really appreciate you having me here today. And thank you for all of your leadership.
Well, it's been incredible to see so much happening in these last few months, in this last year, as we've seen the devastating impact that COVID-19 has had on communities of color, and in particular, the Latino community. I know you understand that a lot of the root of that is really due to systemic inequities that we've seen. I have to tell you, I was very impressed. I met with President Biden a week before the inaugural, and he and Vice President Harris, they were still president-elect and vice president-elect, were part of this meeting with a few Latino leaders. And I was very impressed with President Biden's commitment to equity, especially as it relates to not just the pandemic, but to the vaccine and its distribution and rollout. I wanted to ask you, can you talk, and I know we've had since the last week, the president has announced a big plan as it relates to vaccines. I was wondering if you could talk about the national vaccination plan and the role in particular community level engagement plays in the plan, because we know how important community level engagement is, and we wanted to see how you envision working with community organizations to ensure timely and inclusive access to the COVID vaccine. There's a lot of confusion, and I know there's a lot of work to be done, but I'm wondering if you could address some of that right now.
Oh, absolutely. And these kinds of partnerships are going to be essential, just absolutely critical. First, I do want to just take a moment and give some context to really why we need to do this work urgently. You know, earlier this week, we saw that we surpassed 4,300 deaths in a day. Right now, we're projecting 500,000 lives lost tragically by February. So, you know, as you say, the impact on our communities, on communities of color, has been absolutely devastating. You know, in 2020, we saw that the death rate, you know, for Latinos was approaching 3 times higher than everybody else, right? For white Americans. And to date, 1 in 1,000 Latinos in the US has lost their lives because of COVID-19. So there's a lot that we're carrying. We also see people are suffering from long-term symptoms from COVID-19. So everything that we know now says that we must do everything in our power to prevent infection in the very first place from COVID-19. And, you know, herein is the conversation about vaccine. President Biden is committed to changing the course of the pandemic at every single step. So thinking about equitable distribution and access to the vaccines, but more broadly, addressing those structural underlying root causes and expanding healthcare services to all of the medically underserved communities. So just to your point, the president laid out, you know, 5 points of a COVID-19 vaccination strategy. We need to get more people vaccinated, number one. Number two, we have to create more vaccination sites. And so thinking about these partnerships, these sites need to be in collaboration with community health centers and community-based organizations and really trusted providers. Now we think about working with pharmacies, local and independent, and also using mobile units where we need to. You know, so third, we have to increase our supply. We really have to get more vaccine and get it out the door faster. It's top priority. You know, fourth, we have to be able to mobilize the personnel to do those vaccinations. And fifth, you know, of course, and part of our conversation today is we have to ensure everyone has the information and confidence that they need to get vaccinated.
In particular, you know, it'd be helpful to highlight how President Biden's vaccination plan will ensure that our Latinx communities are not left behind. I don't know if you know, but at UnidosUS, we have a strong track record of working not just on expanding health policy that allows for inclusion and access for our community, but most recently, we've also been at the forefront of working with community-based organizations that are part of our affiliate network. Many of them run health programs or health clinics, but all of them are trusted partners with the community. These UnidosUS affiliates are really seen as the go-to sources, as well as our website and others. Can you maybe drill down on what folks can, where they can go to, though, beyond even organizations on the ground, how they can be most useful?
So let me talk about equity in the vaccination campaign for just a moment and drill down on that. You know, we are going to use data to guide exactly where those vaccines are made available. It's important that anyone who is ready, when it is their turn, be able to get vaccinated. We don't want to see any structural barrier standing in the way, right? So lack of insurance, for example, will not be a barrier to receiving the vaccine. We know it's important the vaccine is free and that no one has any out-of-pocket costs to get vaccinated. And President Biden is committed to that. The national plan that he put forth includes billions of dollars to be able to scale up vaccination in just this way, so that we have community-based vaccination centers. So think about your neighborhood locations, community centers, gyms, stadiums. And we will partner with pharmacies. 90% of Americans live within 5 miles of a pharmacy, but that doesn't preclude the reality that there are pharmacy deserts in many, many Black, Brown, and rural communities where 5 miles is still, quite frankly, very out of reach. So the plan accounts for that. So whether we think about having a hard time potentially reaching a pharmacy or one of those community sites, we'll have those mobile units, right, to be able to get out and reach people where they are.
I guess as a follow-up for you, how does the vaccination plan address community fears of immigration enforcement consequences for themselves or their family when they do go to get vaccinated? Have you talked about that, or can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that is just such an important question. There is a lot of work to do to rebuild trust in, you know, in our country's institutions, and conversations like this are just critical. So the administration is fully aware that many undocumented individuals and mixed status families are understandably distrustful of these institutions. And that's paired with knowing that the risk of exposure, really, to COVID-19 is often higher, right, among people who are undocumented, because so many are essential frontline workers and often work in settings where there is little enforcement, right, of PPE and other important COVID-19 safety mitigation. So on one hand, you know, worker safety is a top priority for the new administration. But more directly to your question, we must make sure that there just aren't any barriers at all, right, that will scare people away from getting the vaccine. And so that even comes down to the registration process. There should not be questions about citizenship status. And identification should not be mandatory. Registration should be available in multiple languages and by telephone and other ways in addition to computers. And vaccination data should not be shared with immigration at all. The vaccine is going to be crucial to bring our whole country to the other side of the pandemic, to our new normal. In order for this to work, we need everyone to have access to the vaccine and to trust the process. So we are 1,000% committed to that.
Let me ask you a question on misinformation. I mean, it's just so confusing out there for all the reasons we've already talked about. But in communities of color, and particularly in our Latino community, there is misinformation and lack of trust related to the vaccine itself. So I guess my question would be for you as it relates to trust. Data shows that people of color are less likely to be vaccinated than their white counterparts. You know, how do you and this administration plan to work to rebuild that trust and provide trusted information and assurance to our communities that that hesitancy is still there? I know we're working on it at UnidosUS. We want to be in partnership with this new administration. But do you want to just comment on that for just a minute, just to see how you want to articulate that?
Yeah, I'm really grateful that you raised disinformation and misinformation, because that's just one of our big tragedies, is how much of that is out there. But we know people have, you know, reasonable questions that deserve clear answers. You know, I am here to say the vaccine is safe, the vaccine is effective, and the processes that got us here were free of political interference. You know, but still yet, we know people will need to hear that message from others. It matters who answers those questions. It really matters that the community's trusted messengers have that information themselves, feel confident themselves in the accuracy of all of those data. So, you know, President Biden has said many times that it is understandable why people might be hesitant, because the federal government has really not always treated particularly Black and Brown communities with the dignity and respect that they deserve. So, you know, we have to go from there, and that's our starting point. But equity is at the core of the work. And as you said, the president has committed to this so many times. So the new administration's plan, we will ensure that communities of color have the information, have the confidence they need, you know, to your point, that it is tailored, it is culturally responsive. So we're gonna do a campaign to get education out there to build that. But we have to do that really just in partnership, as you said, with those who are on the ground, right? Those who know. It's going to go deep. This is going to be neighbors, right? Talking to neighbors and pastors, talking to church members, you know, public health navigators out there, community-based organizations, just existing relationships. So, you know, if I just take a second to give my own kind of personal testimony, because I'm a healthcare worker, and as one, I was vaccinated just recently. You know, my arm was sore for a day. I know people are really worried about these side effects. I know that it is within the range of normal to have had that happen, you know, as it would have been for me to have gotten body aches or a fever. So that's all just evidence the vaccine is doing its job. So I know that I can't get COVID-19 from taking the vaccine. We all have to do what we can to avoid what is the short-term and immediate threat of COVID-19 to our families. And I, like you, want to protect my family.
I can't thank you enough for taking time to spend with us as we launch all of our efforts to make sure we're doing everything we can to engage our community and community-based organizations in this effort. You have demonstrated that personal commitment to our community, and we're so pleased and proud of your leadership as the chair of the Biden-Harris COVID Task Force on Equity in this moment. Count on our continued partnership, and thank you again, Dr. Nunez-Smith.
Thank you.
So let's first off start talking about the clinical aspects of the COVID-19 vaccine, and let's keep it simple. Start from the basics. What exactly do the COVID-19 vaccines do, and why should people get vaccinated? Dr. Sri, we can start with you.
Sure. If we think about vaccines, what we're doing with vaccines is generally training our immune system, which helps protect us against things that are not part of our body, to recognize those things and to help prevent the spread. So with vaccines, the COVID-19 vaccines, we're training our immune system so that if you do get infected with the COVID-19 disease, the virus, that your immune system can be called into action and reduce the spread of COVID-19. And what we're seeing in these COVID-19 vaccines is very high efficacy rates, meaning that it has very high rates of being able to prevent severe COVID-19 disease after you've trained your immune system with these vaccines.
So does that mean that you can still technically get sick, you just get less sick, and can you still transmit COVID if you have received the vaccine?
Two really good questions. So can you still get sick and can you transmit? Let's take them one at a time. What we have seen in the data that for these vaccines, and these, there are two vaccines from Moderna and Pfizer, the data looks similar for both of them, 95% effective What that means is that after you've completed two doses, both of these require you to get two doses, and about 1 to 2 weeks after you get that second dose, you're 95% protected from COVID. So what we know is that there are a small percentage of people who might still get COVID after you have gotten the vaccine, but majority of the times you will not get COVID. In terms of will you have less disease if you do get COVID, there are studies that are ongoing to figure that out. For all, we believe that you would, if you do get COVID, you're less likely to have a less intense case of COVID. But definitively, we won't know that for a little bit of time. So that's important for us to know. The second piece is, could you still infect, have COVID and pass it on to other people after you've had the vaccine? The answer again there is we don't know. What the data shows is that it prevents you from having severe disease or symptomatic disease. You could theoretically still have the virus and pass it on, even though you don't actually get sick from COVID. And therefore, it's really important that after you've gotten the vaccine, to continue to do all the things that we were doing before: hand washing, wearing masks, social distancing. There are studies that are ongoing to determine whether or not it would actually reduce the risk of transmission of the virus, even if you don't get sick. We'll get answers to that in the upcoming months. However, until we know that, it's important to recognize that the vaccine is one of the tools that we have to fight against the spread, and an incredibly important part of our set of tools in preventing this spread of COVID-19 disease.
Well, as you mentioned, I mean, there's still so much that we're learning about the vaccine, and that's why there's a lot of people also that might not trust it as much. Carmen, I'd like to ask you, what are the side effects of the vaccine and how extreme are they? Should we be worried? What could be the possible long-term effects of the vaccine?
So we do know that there are some short-term side effects that you might get within the first 48 hours of receiving the vaccine. Symptoms like having a mild headache, maybe a little bit of nausea, some chills, a little fatigue. These are all side effects that we know to expect within the first 48 hours. They're normal side effects that you would get. You might also have some soreness in your arm from the injection sites. And so that's something that if patients start feeling that within the first 48 hours, it really isn't anything to be too concerned with. If it's not a contraindication, you can take an over-the-counter ibuprofen or acetaminophen to ease with those symptoms. But those first 48 hours, that's what you might expect to see.
And if you're comparing it to other vaccines, let's say compared to the flu vaccine, is it like a relatively normal amount of side effects, would you say? Like, or should we be more worried or more aware of them with the COVID-19 vaccines?
I think it's important to be aware that these are the different side effects that you might have in the first 48 hours. But I don't necessarily think you should be more concerned about them, especially because, you know, we should all know that to expect those side effects in the first 48 hours, and to, you know, contact your physician if the side effects continue anything beyond the 48 hours.
Okay. Dr. Sheree, who should be receiving the COVID-19 vaccine? Is it people of all ages, mothers, fathers, older people, pregnant women? That's a big question. Who should be receiving the vaccine?
Our goal in this country is to make sure that anyone is able to, that can get the vaccine when it's their turn. But let's talk through what that prioritization looks like. The federal government has provided guidelines through the Centers for Disease Control on what the priority population should be, starting with healthcare workers and those individuals who are living in facilities such as skilled nursing facilities and long-term care facilities. And then over time, there's increasing groups of populations that will become eligible. So that's what the federal guidance is. And then what the Centers for Disease Control has done is provided that framework to states and allows states to then determine what's right for their local population. And so to adapt that framework to ensure that the populations receive the vaccine based on availability and local priorities. And as vaccines become more available, the number of people and who is eligible will continue to expand. And so what's important is, depending on where you live, to stay in close contact with your public health authorities, with your clinical providers, your primary care physicians. We at CVS have on cvs.com availability that's on prioritization based on states. But the important thing to know is that your turn will come up as there's more vaccines available. And when it's your turn, it's so important to be able to roll up that sleeve and get that vaccine so that we can all help prevent increasing COVID-19 disease in this country.
Definitely. And Governor Polis, I want to bring you into the conversation now because you have been pretty much at the front line of trying to figure out how to distribute this in your state. How have you been able to do this, and what have been the biggest challenges that you faced?
Well, the single biggest challenge is the lack of enough vaccine to get people vaccinated more quickly. We're currently doing everybody age 70 and up in Colorado, and we've had a focus from the start on equity and serving the medically underserved, including our immigrant community. So how do we do that? The biggest piece is through our hospital system. It certainly serves all different folks, but we work through the community health clinics who know who all their patients are over 70. And then we work in doing stand-up clinics in communities that are medically underserved and don't have a medical home. So right now, everybody over 70 is getting it. We hope in the near future to be able to do that for people age 65 and up. But the sooner we get vaccine, the sooner we do it. Just to put this in perspective, Colorado is a state of about 5.7 million people. We've only been getting about 70,000 vaccines a week. So you can do the math. That takes quite a while till you can reach the type of levels where the pandemic ends. Unfortunately, that speed increase will be at about 90,000 next week. President Biden announced a 16% increase initially. We're hoping that there's additional increases in the near future.
And hopefully more planning on that front, that you'll actually be able to know how many vaccines you're receiving from month to month, so you can actually plan accordingly. But now that we're talking about how we have two vaccines that have been approved for use in the United States, we have the Pfizer, BioNTech, and the Moderna. What is the difference between these two, Ms. Vergara?
Yeah, the Pfizer was approved first, and then the Moderna was approved second. One of the biggest operational differences is the storage of the two. The Pfizer needs ultra cold storage, and the Moderna does not. And so a lot of the community health centers are receiving the Moderna vaccine so that we can more easily distributed to the community as fast as possible, where the Pfizer is in the hospital settings where they might have those storage. But in terms of like clinically and the makeup of the vaccine, there isn't as much difference between the two.
I'm wondering how you're able to get past the misinformation during the time. We've seen so much misinformation on social media. How to establish that trust within the community? Dr. Shree, how have you advised CVS Health to be able to maybe transmit that message to the Latino community specifically?
So it's so important to ensure that you have messages from trusted health sources. We, in December, after the authorization for Pfizer, we conducted a large study across the country of 5,000 individuals to look at what is the hesitancy or acceptability of getting a vaccine. And I know Carmen has done similar amazing research around this topic. And what we both found, and Carmen, I'd ask you to follow up with your findings, is that trusted health professionals that you know are incredibly important for helping you answer the questions that you might have about the vaccine, whether that's your primary care provider or your pharmacist, other trusted health authorities that you know about. And so we have been working to increase the availability of the educational materials. We believe that pharmacists are trusted health professionals that are in the community that can answer your questions. And we are training all our pharmacists about all of the characteristics, the efficacy and safety of the COVID-19 vaccine. We're making this information available at cvshealth.com as well. But I can't emphasize enough, there are so many trusted health authorities that are out there that are ready to answer your questions. And we're all here to make sure that you have what you need so that you can make the right decision. And knowing the data about both of these vaccines, they're both incredibly effective in very low side effect rates, and will really be an important tool for us to get to the other side of the pandemic. Carmen, if you wanna add based on your research as well.
Sure, our team sends out a survey to our patients in both Spanish and in English, and we received a pretty high response rate from our patients who are primarily Spanish speaking. 5.9% of our patients responded, and 85% of those who said that they were comfortable getting the vaccine said that they were comfortable if it was recommended by their doctor and provider. So we were really encouraged to see that result. And we were also encouraged to see that as patients were a bit older, their comfort level and likelihood of getting the vaccine increased. So we were happy to see that. And even now, as we started to give the vaccine out to our patients over the age of 65, as of about 10 days ago, we're seeing the same thing happen in person as what we saw in the survey. So of all of the proactive calls that we're making to patients, offering to book them an appointment for the vaccine, about 85% are saying yes to the appointment and are coming in to receive the vaccine. So we're very encouraged by what we're seeing at least at this initial stage.
I think that that's one of probably like the biggest challenges is getting actually people to reach out and get information. Governor Polis, how are you dealing with this in your state? How are you communicating with the community to make sure that they're able to actually get in and get the vaccine?
Well, we have a very diverse state, as you know, in Colorado. One of the things that all of our partners, and remember, it's not so much the state that does the vaccinations, but it's hospitals, pharmacies, community health clinics, and then stand-up clinics that we usually do in partnership with a city or a fire department or a sheriff's department. That'll be in a parking lot for a weekend. But for our major partners like hospitals, they have public-facing portals where people can sign up in Spanish and English. They also have established call-in lines, and we also have a state call-in line, 877-CO-VAX-CO. It's in Espanol y Inglés. And so we are trying to make that available to folks. We know that when, especially with people over 70, Nicole, not all of them are proficient at the internet, right? It's not so much a language thing, but many 80-year-olds and 85-year-olds, they might not be comfortable or able to sign up online. So we wanna make sure as an alternative, they have a phone number to call where they can sign up to get the vaccine.
So now what everybody is asking themselves is how, when, where can I get my vaccine? You know, how can we expect that timeline to kind of develop in the next couple of months? Let's say we know now that the healthcare workers are being vaccinated, people over 70. Is that going to vary from state to state, or once it's available for 50 plus, is it going to be nationwide?
It does vary state to state. So in Colorado, we have 530,000 people over age 70, and we want to get mostly through that population before we can move on and expand it. Other states are doing slightly different orders, the way they treat or consider different pre-existing conditions. But in general, across the country, which makes sense given the impact of the virus, older Americans are going first. Some states are just doing 75 and up. Some are doing 70 and up, some might already be at 65 and up where we will be soon. But generally there's an age-based criteria, a pre-existing condition-based criteria. And then the final one, Nicole, is the profession-based criteria. So that's people who worked in hospitals, medical workers, first responders. Many states are phasing in when do teachers get it, when do other essential workers like grocery and restaurant workers get it. So, by profession, by age, and by pre-existing condition are the three ways that people qualify.
Well, you mentioned that the vaccine strategy is directly linked to employment, but we now have seen record unemployment numbers in the U.S. How do we get people out to get vaccinated and work around that, Dr. Shree?
So Governor Polis did a great overview of how the approach to prioritization. Employment status is only one of the criteria. Most of the criteria will largely be, as we move forward with more vaccine availability, based on age and your health. And so as we continue to expand, what we'll see is starting at an age cut point, maybe of 75 in a particular state, and then moving down to 65, then moving to individuals who have other health conditions. So employment is one way, but not the only way to qualify for vaccines. And again, I can't iterate enough that our goal as a country is to ensure that everyone has availability of the vaccine. And so employment, I want to emphasize, is only one of many criteria, but not the only criteria by which we'll determine who will be able to get a vaccine.
Carmen, is the vaccine free? Would you like to add something? Go ahead.
I would. I think it's a great point that you bring up, because we don't want to miss or delay for folks who are unemployed, because they have a whole other set of risk factors just by the nature of being unemployed, in addition to the people who work in the homes and who are disproportionately women. So we also want to keep that in mind as we're thinking about like equitable distributions. But you were going to ask me about cost. There should be no cost to the vaccine to the patients. So patients should not worry about having to pay for the vaccine or about getting a bill for the vaccine.
Okay, and is there any specific documentation that's required? Any specific proof of age? What would they need to bring that day?
You know, we don't want to collect anything that's unnecessary. We don't want to discourage or create red tape for people to get the vaccine. So the least amount of information that we need to collect, I think, is what we're aiming for. We do need some basic demographic information so that we can keep close contact with patients to make sure that they follow up for their second visit. If a person happens to have insurance, we could get reimbursement from insurance. It is the responsibility of insurance is to pay for the vaccine, and that helps our overall healthcare system. But otherwise, you know, we wouldn't want to be collecting anything that is too sensitive or is unnecessary for the process for patients.
Especially because we know that so many undocumented immigrants are also essential workers that might qualify for a vaccine at this moment. Is that the reason why you also don't collect that sensitive information?
Yes, we don't want that to be a barrier. I'm afraid of where this information is going to go. So it's just a very basic name, date of birth, phone number, basic contact information for us to be able to keep close follow-up with the patient.
Governor Polis, has there been an effort to get more vaccines out to the immigrant community, to that essential worker community?
Yes. Well, a lot of our immigrant community works in essential jobs. So as we move into the phase where we're able to support workers in agriculture, meat processing, grocery stores, there's a built-in level of increased diversity in that group. Less so in the age-based criteria. That's everybody over 70, everybody over 65. While, of course, there are many people of all races of those ages, our own Latino population in Colorado, I think it's the same in the country, trends younger. There's a lot of younger folks, a lot of families. So we hope to be able to achieve those equity numbers as we get into those profession-based strategies.
Dr. Sheree, what would you say is the most easy way to get information or find a way to make an appointment right now? If I wanted to call, or what would be the easiest way to make an appointment right now? Information that could generally be used state to state.
Sure. So each state has resources available through their departments of public health. So being able to go to your department of public health to find out who's eligible and where is their vaccine that's available. And then in addition to that, working with your trusted health partners at CVS.com, we will be increasingly opening up retail pharmacy sites across the country as vaccine becomes available, and we'll continue to update our own availability on our website. In addition to the public health websites, looking at the websites of the health systems that are in your area, the hospitals or your physician's offices. So there's multiple sources. And over time, the Centers for Disease Control will also have a set of resources available to help you find where vaccines might be in your community. But really in these, at this time, looking at public health, hospital systems, as well as at CVS.com, you'll find when and where there's availability based on your prioritization.
That's so, so important. I mean, I think it's just, again, that lack of information, that mistrust within the community about the vaccine. There's also a lot of worry for about the insufficient amount of vaccine. Governor Paulus, what do you say to those people who are worried that there just simply won't be enough vaccines?
Well, there will be, and it's a question of when. Unfortunately, for somebody who contracts COVID, it's already too late. So we are rapidly across the country vaccinating folks. In Colorado, we're at about 8% of the population that's received at least the first dose. And across the country, it's around 6 or 7%. So we're getting there. But, you know, until we reach that 60-70% level, we don't really have community-wide protection. It's still a pandemic. And obviously, people are greatly relieved once they have that protection personally through the highly effective vaccine.
Governor, what would you say is what you need the most in this moment to be able to have even more of a successful vaccine rollout? I mean, it's one that's been plagued with lots of headaches for different states. So as governors are trying to figure out how to tackle this from state to state, what would you say is what you need the most at this moment?
Well, I think what I'm most hopeful for is the, you know, forthcoming approval of additional vaccines, Johnson & Johnson and AstraZeneca are two that we hope will be approved in short order, opening up new supply, Johnson & Johnson one dose, easier to administer, no extreme refrigeration requirements. And of course, on the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines, it's simply significantly increased quantity. We could successfully use, you know, 4 or 5 times as much vaccine as we're currently getting each week in Colorado and across the country to really reach the level of protection that ends the pandemic.
Okay, definitely. Great. Well, I'd like to open up to questions from the people that are participating. I know that one person asked, what's the difference between the first dose and the second dose? Dr. Shree, why is that important?
So, it's a great question, and it reemphasizes the point that to have the full efficacy of the vaccine, you need to get the first and the second dose. One of the vaccines, you get the second dose after 21 days, and then Pfizer, and then for Moderna, that's 28 days. But when you get your first dose, you'll be advised on what's the right amount of time, and likely also be scheduled for that second appointment. In terms of the differences, there really is no difference. It's a second dose. You might have a little bit more pain or a little bit more side effects after the second dose. But again, as Carmen had talked about, most people, if they do get those symptoms resolve after 24 to 48 hours or with Tylenol or ibuprofen, but really there is no difference in the two doses, but I can't emphasize enough that to get the full efficacy of the vaccine, it is important to get both doses.
But we've been also running into some issues of some states that have had to cancel the second dose for a lot of their patients. Carmen, have you run into this problem?
Well, we're still just finishing up we're at the 4 week mark at the moment. So we're just at the moment where we're having our second round of vaccines coming in. And so thankfully we have not run into this problem, and I hope that continues, but we're also being strategic with how we set appointments so that we're not overbooking when we're not 100% sure of the supply. But I agree with what the governor has said and with Dr. Shree that the more we know what to expect, the more agile we are to move and get ahead and schedule more patients to come in.
Definitely.
And if I can add, life gets in the way, and sometimes you just can't make that second appointment or something happens. It's okay. Ideally, you get that second dose when you've been recommended, but for some reason you miss that second appointment, reschedule when you can. And it's important to get that second dose when you can. It's okay to be late. We don't recommend it, but complete that second dose to get the full efficacy when you can.
Is there kind of a time limit? Could you say you could go over maybe a couple of days? Or
at this point, our recommendation is just get it when you can, and you will get the efficacy after you complete that second dose.
Okay, definitely.
You don't want to get it earlier than when you need to, but it's okay if it goes past a bit.
Okay, and there's also been some talk of vaccines that simply have not gotten into the arms of people and have to had been discarded or thrown away. Governor, have you had this issue in your state?
We put a rule in place when we started to distribute the vaccine with all of our partners that every dose has to be used within 3 days or we reassign it, meaning we move it to another provider. And we've very rarely had to do that. Generally, the warning is enough to be able to use it. There's been, you know, a few acts of God, if you will. There was a power outage in one facility, a freezer went down, we lost 120 doses. I think that kind of thing is going to happen in the real world, but very de minimis. We're using every dose. And in fact, when they do have additional dosage, if they don't have enough people, our guidance is to go beyond our guidelines of 70 and up. And if you have like one extra dose or two extra doses, you don't throw it out. You give it to whoever you have there and whoever's able to take it at that time.
On that note, there's also been a lot of talk of people waiting around at clinics, at hospitals till the end of the day in hopes of getting an extra vaccine. Have you heard or seen of that, Dr. Shree?
Yes, that does happen. It is not the ideal way to get a vaccine because then there's no reassurance that you'll have the second dose because you're not being scheduled in a traditional clinical setting with at a health center or a pharmacy or a hospital. So the recommendation would be to work and follow what the availability is from public health departments so that you can get it from a trusted health provider. And that way you'll have both doses scheduled and get the full efficacy of the vaccine. We understand that people do sometimes wait for that dose, but that is not an ideal way to get vaccinated at this time.
Especially because some people have been waiting hours or even days. We have Amy Suman. She asks, how many days after you get the second dose do you get full efficacy of the vaccine?
Sure. So you can correct me if I'm wrong, Dr. Shree, but I believe that it's like 7 full weeks. What was studied in the studies that after you get the second dose, in the total from when you received the first dose to 7 weeks is when you should be at that 94-95% efficacy.
So it would be about 3 weeks after the second dose, Dr. Shree?
Yeah, I mean, what we're seeing is that after about 2 weeks to 3 weeks after the second dose is when you get that full efficacy. And so it's important after you get your first dose to continue to wear that mask, socially distance, hand wash. And even after the second dose, you're not getting that full efficacy. We also talked earlier in this conversation about the fact that we don't know, even if you've gotten the vaccine, you could still potentially transmit COVID-19 to other individuals. And so by continuing to wear a mask, socially distance and hand washing, you'll help prevent transmission at the same time being protected by the vaccine after that second dose, couple weeks after the second dose.
Okay, great. I also have this is a great question. How can we easily explain to our Latinx rural communities about how the vaccine was developed so quickly? There's so much doubt around that. And maybe Cartman, you've had direct contact with the Latino community and you've been able to kind of talk them through that. How have you been able to do that?
Yeah, it's a question that we get pretty regularly. Like, how did this happen so fast? And, you know, we try to reassure that the studies for these vaccines went through the same rigorous protocol as other vaccines. And so I think that because it's been in many people, not their lifetime, that they've seen this a new vaccine develop, we're not as familiar with it, but we try to reassure that the same rigorous process was followed for everyone and that it was very, very methodical, that there's checks and balances to just really make sure that the right protocols are being followed. And we also know that now there's better technology to speed things up a little bit faster. And that's also a factor at play with why it was developed, you know, a bit faster. And so providing that reassurance from our clinical providers has been key because as a medical home, our patients rely on the advice of their clinical providers who will reassure them, not just of this vaccine, but any other vaccine. And so that's how we've been trying to get the message across to our patients.
All right. Would anybody like to add anything else before we try to show this video one more time?
I would just add that, look, when you have the opportunity to get this life-saving vaccine, you should get it. And it may be next week if you're in your 70s or 60s, it may be in a month, it may be in 3 months. But when your turn is up, roll up your sleeve, help not just save your own life, but also help end the pandemic and save the lives of your friend and family.
Dr. Shree?
Couldn't have said it better than the governor. When it's your turn, roll up your sleeve. It's incredibly safe. It's incredibly efficacious. It protects you from severe COVID-19 and symptomatic COVID-19 disease. So thank you all for joining us today and learning more about the COVID-19 vaccines. And we hope that you'll take these messages and share them with your family and loved ones and amplify these messages. It's so important that we all get the vaccine when it's our turn.
Hopefully you have been able to take something useful out of this conversation today. And before we go, I'd like to also give you a few tools that you could use. Also, going to the CDC website for the latest information is extremely important. Visit the Unidos COVID-19 page with information in English and in Spanish. And you can also follow We Are Unidos US on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Also, very important, stay tuned to your local newscast for all the updated information. We know that things are constantly changing. And start a conversation with your doctor, with your provider. Don't be afraid to actually call out to different organizations and say, hey, I want information. It simply does not hurt to ask. Also, you can go to planyourvaccine.com or planificatuvacuna.com. This is the initiative that NBC News has and NBC Universal and Telemundo has to help you plan your COVID-19 vaccine. We know that there's still a lot of doubts, there's still a lot of questions out there. And here you'll be able to find information state to state as to what you need to do to actually get vaccinated. So as soon as that website goes live, you'll have access to it, but you can register for that now. Again, it's planyourvaccine.com, planificatuvacuna.com. We have it in English and in Spanish, so that way you can know everything from costs to where you can get your vaccine and everything else you need to know. I'd like to thank our participants one more time before leaving, Carmen Vergara, Dr. Shree Shanguturo, and Governor Paulus for participating in this conversation tonight, this very, very important conversation tonight. Again, I hope you got some good use out of this time. So I want to thank you so much also for allowing me to be a part of it. My name is Nicole Suarez. I'm anchor for Noticias Telemundo. Stay healthy, stay informed, and we'll be back soon with much more information. Hasta la próxima.